Shalom. Kol halal Yahweh by Shemel Shai, by Hashem Kakadash. Double honors unto the apostles and the elders. Salutations to all my fellow laborers doing this work in truth and sincerity, risking their lives and their freedom to do so now more so than ever. To the scattered elect that are scattered around the four corners of the earth, that be like unto the speckled bird, the Israelite foreigners. And to the Akwath that are listening and learning to you, I say Shalom. This is your brother Malcolm from the branch of the Great Millstone here in Chicago, coming at you with another lesson. And this lesson is going to be inspired by some unfortunate events and some as a result of some responses on the comment board that kind of well, let's put it this way. Let me read a scripture to better explain it. And that scripture is going to be Mark. Let's go to Mark first. This is the book of Mark. The sixth chapter. And the fourth verse. All right. And it reads, And it reads, "But Yahawashah said unto them, A prophet is not without honor, but in his own country, and amongst his own kin, and in his own house." All right. And he could do no mighty work, save that he laid his hands upon a few sick folk and healed them, and he have marveled because of their unbelief, and that he went round about the villages teaching. So often the people closest to you don't realize your worth. They don't realize who you are, and they look at you as a regular person. They don't look at you as a prophet of the Lord. They don't look at you as a man of the Lord. They look at you as that person that they know, not understanding who you are and who you're representing. All right, and then they would judge you like they would a normal person. You know, as if you're not sacrificing yourself, your freedom, your body to the elements, your time, you know, year after year after year. You know, for the Lord and for your people, and they just accuse you of folly. All right, let's grab another quick scripture. This is the book of Luke, the fourth chapter, and the sixth, 24th verse, and it reads. And he said, and this is in red, so this is Yahawashah speaking. Verily, I say unto you, no prophet is accepted in his own country. So among your own people, your friends, your family, your loved ones, your wife, your wives, often you're not looked at as a prophet at all or treated as such. And that's just the honest truth. And sometimes people around you can actually get angry for you caring for and fleeing the flock. All right? It can become a problem. And you also got your family members, your loved ones, that would just scoff the hell out of you as well. All right? And with that in mind, I'm going to play a video that Yehemiah, the Mighty Murph, put up, and it was called The Ungrateful Rewarded. All right, it was called The Ungrateful Rewarded. So, without any further ado, let's do it.
You know, this lesson, all right, is concerning these degenerate, ungrateful, unholy, unthankful Israelites out here, man, because here it is, starting with the elders and apostles on down.
Now he's doing a walk and talk, you know, just so you know, he's out at night doing a walk and talk, you know, and it's a very spiritual conversation and lesson, but let's continue.
You know, for decades, starting with the apostles and elders on down, for decades, men have been out here presenting their bodies as a living sacrifice, teaching this truth. All right, mortifying the deeds of their flesh. You know, putting the whole world behind them. Men sacrificed their lives, their careers, their families.
Now, what did he mean by mortifying the deeds of their flesh? All right, denying pleasures. All right, denying sin. Denying those things that their bodies desire, knowing that it's sinful. Which often is those that don't do those things that open their mouths and come against the Lord. Because what they don't understand is that when you're coming against a man of the Lord, you're coming against Yahweh himself. You're coming against Yahweh Shai.
All right. Putting everything behind us. Casting all these things off to give you Israelites the message of eternal life. And all you niggas can do is scoff, you know. But all the pride is about to be brought to a stop. All the haughtiness is about to be brought to a stop. A lot of fucking faces is going to be shut pretty soon, man. All right? And it's about to get real cold, man. It's about to get real dark for you two-thirds, man. You scoffers. Especially you scoffers who have family members that's Israelites. All right? You women that have husbands that's Israelites. You know, too. You know? Those people with family members that's Israelites. Who actually have family members that's Israelites to care to tell them? Because I don't tell these niggas shit, all right? But, I tell them. I ain't laboring with them, though, unless they got an ear to hear. But nevertheless, they know what's up. They know why I ain't at that wicked-ass so-called Christmas dinner. But nevertheless, you know, you people, you know, you wives, your girlfriends, because a wife is a girlfriend, or you brothers, or cousins that got an Israelite that's laboring with you, you are the most ungrateful, unholy person that has ever graced the face of the earth, walked the face of the earth, so to speak, and especially in these times, all right? These people, you know, that's familiar with us, they don't value us, you know? But those same...
And there it is, man. The people that's familiar with us don't value us. They don't. And familiarity breeds contempt. It does. Matter of fact, I looked that word up. It says familiarity, close acquaintance with knowledge of something, the relaxed friendliness or intimacy between people. And that can help make me think of the story of with Moses and what happened between him, his brother, and his sister. All right. This is a book of Numbers, the 12th chapter. And I'm going to start at verse 1 and read to like verse 10. And it reads, "And Miriam and Aaron spake against Moses because of the Ethiopian woman, which he had married, for he had married an Ethiopian woman." And on another note, that kills that mamzer garbage about, you know, all that mitochondrial DNA, all those stupid arguments. All right. Moses' children were Israelites because he was. All right. His wife was a Hamite. Point blank, period. The tribe of Ephraim and Manasseh, their mothers were Hamites. There would be no tribe of Ephraim and Manasseh if your mother determined your nationality. The people saying that are wicked, they're evil, and they are going to be put to death. All right. Back to the lesson at hand. All right. And they said, "Hath Yahweh indeed spoken only by Moses? Have he not spoken also by us?" And Yahweh heard it. And now the man Moses was very meek above all the men that were upon the face of the earth. And Yahweh spake suddenly unto Moses and unto Aaron and unto Miriam and said, "Come out, ye three, unto the tabernacle of the congregation." And they three came out. And Yahweh came down in a pillar of a cloud and stood in the door of the tabernacle, and Aaron and Miriam, and they both came forth. And he said, "Hear now my words. If there be a prophet among you, I, Yahweh, will make myself known unto him in a vision and will speak unto him in a dream. My servant Moses is not so, who is faithful in all mine house. With him I speak mouth to mouth, even apparently, and not in dark speeches, and in similitude of Yahweh shall he behold. Wherefore then were ye not afraid to speak against my servant Moses? And the anger of Yahweh was kindled against them, and he departed, and the cloud departed off the tabernacle. And behold, Miriam became leprous as snow, and Aaron looked upon Miriam, and behold, she was leprous. Right? Her melanin, her pigment was taken away. Right? Nothing happened to Aaron. Right? Because Aaron is a man. Miriam being the woman was out of order. All right? She was completely and totally out of order. And that's basically the house of Israel, and often the people of your very household, wives and girlfriends included. They don't regard how they speak to you, how they talk to you, or how they treat you, because they see you just as they saw all the men that they were with before in the world, or the people that they were with in the world. All right? They don't set you apart from them, and they know not the wickedness that they do and what they can do to themselves as a result of that. All right? Let's listen to a little bit more mirth.
Wives, you know, girlfriends, cousins, family members, or brothers you preach the word to, if you got $10-20 million tomorrow, out of all that scoff, and they'll find a reason to like you. But see, they don't see us as that precious gold that Yahweh Hashem Yahweh Shah set us up to be. They're familiar. They just see us as niggas, so they scoff. But listen, man, the greatest judgment that's ever been known to man, the most catastrophic judgment that's ever been known to man, is about to happen. All right, it's about to happen very soon. And that judgment is stored up for somebody. So, like I say, man, this is the 2/3 last shot, man. Rather be your cousin, the nigga at your job, you know, your boss fire you, your boss give you shit, you know, your woman commit adultery, probably with your cousin, you know, run off with some nigga, no matter what. Look, see, this is the spirit of so-called Christmas. Dead! Nigga, ain't no fucking Christmas around here, nigga. But nevertheless, you know, whatever may happen, man, these people, you gotta let them take their best shot, man. Cause this their last shot. This is the 2/3 last shot. Hey, and like the brother Yasha Allah say here in the Great Millstone Chicago camp, hey, this our last shot to cry out. This our last shot to, you know, seek and ask and please for the Lord's mercy, his salvation, his forgiveness. So, hey, that's the scripture.
And see, there we are, man. And I'm getting to the point, well, you know what? I'm not getting to the point. I've gotten to the point where I'm numb. You know, that was a famous song, actually, from Pink Floyd, which is actually my favorite song from them, called Comfortably Numb. Because now I have become comfortably numb. I've become numb to this world. I'm becoming numb to emotions, numb to love, numb to caring. The only thing I care about is serving Yahweh Hashem Yahushai, doing the work of the Lord, and the care over the flock which the Lord has given me. Everything else is becoming nothing, because it means nothing. All right, this is Matthew 13:57, and it reads, "And they were offended in him, but Yahushai said unto them, A prophet is not without honor, save in his own country and in his own house." All right. In verse 58. "And he did not many mighty works there because of their unbelief." All right. Because of their unbelief. All right. So that is enough of that. Because they went from the beautiful, soothing opera music. And had the nerve to bring what? One of them scoffing nigga woman. With that Sweet Jesus song. Alright? Ruined it. That station don't even play that kind of music. Alright? That is a classic and opera channel. You see what I mean? Satan is constantly at work. But this is the book of Sirach. Let's go to it. The 36th chapter. in the 24th verse. And it reads, "He that getteth a wife getteth possession, and a help like unto himself, and a pillar of rest." So ask yourself, are you being all those things to your husband, or are you just a thorn in his side? Call halal yahweh by shinab shai by shimbakapadash wa ababa ba shalawam kwam yasharela.